So let's take a moment to take a deep breath and center ourselves this morning by our station.
One God, who makes all things new, whose mercy endures forever.
Amen.
Trusting in God's mercy, let us confess our sin. Holy One, source of our renewal, we confess that we are wrapped up in sin and cannot free ourselves. We have
not practiced your righteousness. Our hearts have turned away from you. For the sake of the world you send out, forgive us, that we may be reconciled to one another, for the glory of your holy name.
Thank you. The first reading comes from Deuteronomy chapter 30. This is the last instruction, so to speak, that Moses is giving to the people of Israel as he is ready to give the scepter over to Joshua, because Moses will not enter.
The promised land. Moses said to the people, "See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord your God, in walking in his ways, observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away, and you do not hear, but led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him, and holding fast to him, for that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob." The word of the Lord. As people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for solid food. Even now you are still not ready, for you still are of the flesh. For as long as there's jealousy and quarreling among you, you are not of the flesh and behaving according to human inclinations. For when one says, I belong to Paul, and another, I belong to Apollos, are you not merely human? What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants, through whom you came to believe as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. The one who plants and the one who waters have a common purpose, and each will receive wages according to the labor of each. For we are God's servants working together. You are God's field, God's building. The word of the Lord.
To the disciples, you have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, you shall not murder, and whoever murders shall be liable to judgment. But I say to you that you, if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, you fool, you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you are offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother or sister, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you're on the way to court with him, or your accuser may hand you over to the judge, and the judge to the guard, and you will be thrown into prison. Truly I tell you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if you lose one of your members, then your whole Oh my goodness. It is better for you to, wow, I'm just really going to read that line again. It is also said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that anyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of unchastity, causes her to commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, you shall not swear falsely, but carry out the vows you have made to the Lord. But I say to you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let your word be yes, yes, or no, no. Anything more than this comes from the evil one. The Gospel of our Lord. Please be seated. So I'm going to start by telling you a little bit about how I write sermons. I usually write it during the week, depending on how the week goes. Usually I try Wednesday morning, Thursday. If the week goes really, really bad, it ends up being Friday on my day off with Jane kind of running around.
And then every Saturday evening, I read over what I had wrote during the week and kind of fine-tune it. And then on Sunday morning, I kind of talk it out to myself to try to get it in my brain a little bit more. And so this Saturday evening, last night, I read over the sermon that I wrote this week, and it was on the gospel reading, which is week 3 of us reading our gospel reading of the Sermon on the Mount. And in the sermon, I wrote about the law. I write a bit about the small catechism for you and Luther's understanding of the law. I talked about how God really cares for our relationships. And I read it and I thought, this sermon is bad. It's boring. And Thomas has a friend sleeping over today, and my house is crazy, so there's no sermon writing that's going to happen tonight. So I was like, well, it's going to be a boring day tomorrow. And then I woke up this morning, and I just couldn't let go of our second reading. And so I've done something I don't think I have ever done in my almost 10 years of ministry. And of course, Dr. Grafton, my seminary professor, walks in when I'm doing this today. So there's that. And then poor Jeff, it's the first sermon he gets to hear when he went from Rachel Anderson to now me. So I'm just going to promise this is not the norm. So I tossed that sermon in the trash because it was boring. And for some reason, the second reading just is grabbing me. Maybe I'm going to blame Thursday morning Bible study crew because we had a bit of a talk about it. I am not as prepared as I normally am for a sermon because what I have on this paper, I wrote at 8 o'clock in the Highland Park Market parking lot before I walked in at 8:30 to pick up the cake for coffee hour. So all that is to say that sometimes the Spirit just grabs you and it just holds on to you, and I don't have it completely figured out why the Spirit has grabbed hold of me with this second text. And I wish I could say I have it all figured out. All I can tell you is that I'm still wrestling with it. And I'm just going to share with you how I'm wrestling with it, because perhaps maybe it's going to grab onto you too and sit with you too. And so, where am I now on my 8 o'clock this morning piece? So, our second reading is Paul writing to the community in Corinth, and it is not a particularly nice letter that he is writing to them. He is not super happy with them. And in Bible study, I read part of the translation called The Message, which is by Eugene Peterson. It is, I always like to give the heads up, I don't find it to be the most scholarly. It's just one man that kind of sat down and translated the whole Bible in attempting to get kind of the same punch that it would have held in ancient times for us today. But sometimes I think it's really good for us to hear his version. So I'm gonna read that to you, even though it's really small, and I think I need to get my eyes checked, given how I've been lately. So let's see how this goes. I might need other glasses. So, huh? I know I might need bifocals. I'm gonna take you up on that. Let's see how this goes. Just really gone by the seat of your pants. Oh, that is a little bit better. Hey, does this mean I'm getting old? Like, how does this? Okay. So 1 Corinthians 3, according to the Message. But for right now, friends, I'm completely frustrated by your unspiritual dealings with each other and with God. You're acting like infants in relation to Christ, capable of nothing much more than nursing at the breast. Well, then I'll nurse you, since you don't seem capable of anything more. As long as you grab for what makes you feel good or what makes you look important, are you really much different than a babe at the breast, content only when everything's going your way? When one of you says, I'm on Paul's side, and the other says, I'm for Apollos, aren't you being totally infantile? Who do you think Paul is anyway? Or Apollos, for that matter. Servants, both of us, servants who waited on you as you gradually learned to entrust your lives to our mutual master. We each carried out our servant assignment. I planted the seed. Apollos watered the plants. God made you grow. It's that last, thank you. That was better. I might need to get some of these. Oh, thank you. That last line just is holding on to me. According to the NRSV, so neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but God who gives us growth. I just find it so beautiful. And it's just so true also. And I think we often forget it. Or perhaps maybe I forget it. Maybe sometimes the reason this is clinging on to me is because sometimes I feel like not only do we need to plant and water, but then somehow by sheer will force it to grow because we put so much time and energy into it. We've built it and we loved it, and well, now it's not sprouting in the same way that it always has. So if I just stare at it long enough, if I just try harder, it's going to produce fruit. But that's putting it on me, right? And that's exactly what Paul is reminding us against. I was reminded this morning when I was sitting in the parking lot of my grandfather, who in his retirement, he started a big garden. And his way of gardening was he just kind of took the little seeds off of potatoes and threw them in the ground and just kind of liked to see what happened. It was like he was doing his own experiment. So he would plant corn, and one year he would get no corn because all the groundhogs ate it all. So the next year he would plant double the amount, figuring I will feed the groundhogs and then I will have a crop for myself. But then, of course, the groundhogs didn't touch the corn. And I'll never forget him pulling up, and he has an entire trunk load full of corn, and he opens up the trunk, and my Nana looks at him and says, "Now, Earl, what am I supposed to do with all this corn?" But the beauty of how he gardened, is he just planted, he watered it, he tended it, and then he just kind of forgot it. And he just saw what happened, and he marveled when it didn't work out. And he equally marveled when he had a trunk load full of corn, too. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God gives who gives the growth. I think the other part that is grabbing onto me is that this doesn't let us off the hook either. This isn't just saying, it's a moment to throw up your hands. God will provide. We don't need to do anything, and we don't really need to be a part of it. God is going to make sure things happened. We just kind of stand back and see how it turns out. It still says that there needs to be someone to plant. It still says someone who needs to water as well. We still do the work. But it's when it does work out or it doesn't work out that it's not on us. Instead, we marvel at what God is doing. We marvel at how it grows. I think that means sometimes we plant and we water and something doesn't grow, which may mean that God is telling us that's not quite the direction that we are supposed to go. And so then we let it go. And then we come over here and we plant and water again and we see what happens. And when fruit is produced, we don't say, "Well, look at me, I willed that to happen." But we marvel at what God is doing. We marvel at the miracle of God at work in our world and in our lives. So I'm just going to leave you with a few questions that I am still sitting with, and I leave them with you to possibly still sit with too. Where do you see God at work and growing in your life? Where do you see God at work in this community of faith? How are we watering and planting? How are we sustaining one another in our journey of faith? What do you need to feel watered and tended and cared for? how can we push past just coming to church to kind of go through the motions week after week and to feel really good about coming here because it is good? But how can we make worship a time that we are sent out feeling ready and called and aware of how God is at work? I don't have any of those answers, but I'm letting you know I'm wrestling with those too. And I hope you'll wrestle with me also in that, because I think that's what God is at work. There's a reason that this is just grabbing, and I don't know where it's going, but I think we'll be able to figure it out together. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. Thanks be to God for that. Amen.
Thank you.
like to invite Joe, the chair of the Musician Search Committee, and Jeff. We get to see how fast he comes downstairs now. Just kidding, we're not timing you. As we get to install and bless Jeff among us as our director of music. So you can come right here.
After prayerful deliberation, we of Emmanuel Lutheran Church have appointed Jeff Soroyes to serve in the position of director of music.
Our Lord Jesus, who came among us as a servant, calls us to faith and a life of loving service to our neighbor. You come among us as one invited to render a particular service, a gift from God to inspire us to love and good works. Jeff, in the presence of this assembly, will you commit yourself to this new trust and responsibility in the confidence that it comes from God? If you will, please say, I will, and I ask God to help you.
Will
you carry out this ministry in accordance with the Holy Scriptures and with the confessions of the Lutheran Church and in harmony with the constitutions of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America? Will you be diligent in your study of the Holy Scriptures and faithful in your use of the means of grace and in prayer? Trusting in God's care, will you seek to grow in love for those you serve, strive for excellence in your skill, and adorn the gospel of Jesus Christ with a godly life? Almighty God, who has given you the will to do these things, graciously give you the strength and compassion to perform them. And may you please stand as you are able. Now, people of God, will you receive Jeff into this ministry as one sent to serve in the Church of Jesus Christ? Will you pray for him, help and honor him for his work's sake, and all things strive to live together in the peace and unity of Christ? Very enthusiastically, please say.
We will,
and ask God to help us. Right. Very good. Jeff, I now declare to you installed as director of music. Almighty God bless you and direct your days and your deeds in peace, that you may be a faithful servant of Christ. Amen. O God of majesty, whom saints and angels delight to worship, strengthen and bless your servant Jeff, who through your gift of music seeks to enliven our praises and proclaim your word with power. Through this ministry, give us new awareness of your beauty and grace, and join our voices with all the choirs of heaven. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Now let us proclaim our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living.
Called together to follow Jesus, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Inspire your church that it may be a sign of life throughout the world, from the exploration of faith with children and new believers to missionaries and bishops. Shape lives of faithfulness so that all find abundant life in your ways. Merciful God, nourish your creation. Accompany all who plant and water. Bless the work of farmers, Provide for subsistence farmers facing drought and climate change. Guide the work of agricultural scientists toward sustainable ways to feed the world. Be with Turkey and Syria in the aftermath of the earthquakes. Merciful God, give growth where there seems to be no hope for life. In nations and regions where reconciliation seems impossible, empower peacemakers with your spirit. Where death holds sway through violence, disease, and hunger, equip relief workers to bring hope. Merciful God, nurture all in need, bringing healing to all who experience trauma caused by systems of injustice and destructive relationships. Give courage to those struggling to repent and those seeking reconciliation. Sustain all who work for restoration. Merciful God, encourage this congregation. Call us to a common purpose and keep us from quarreling. Turn our hearts toward you and guide our leaders so that our choices may be life-giving for all. Merciful God, thanks be to you for the lives of all who have died in Christ. Teach us to follow them in your ways and gather us with them into the promise of eternal life with you. Merciful God, receive our prayers. We bring to you our needs and hopes, O God, trusting your wisdom and power revealed in Christ crucified.
Please stand as you are able. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us greet one another with a sign of that peace.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Liberating God, you break the bonds of injustice and let the oppressed go free. Receive these offerings in thanksgiving for all your works of merciful power, and shape us as people of your justice and freedom. You we magnify and adore through Jesus Christ our Savior.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and he broke it. And he gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory.
Please be seated as our communion assistants come forward. Just a quick word about how communion will work. A reminder that we will begin with it would be my right side, your left side, moving from the front to the back. You're invited to come down the center aisle on the aisle that is closest to the pews. We'll come forward to receive bread on the floor. And for those of you who would like to come up to the altar rail, you're invited to come down on the other side and come directly up by the middle staircase, gather around the altar rail. The only thing that we heard about last week is just if you could make sure to go back to your seat. There's steps on either side. If you could make sure to go back to your seat on the side that you took communion, not on the side that you're sitting in right now, it will help the flow of traffic. And if you're coming forward to receive on the floor, you'll receive a piece of a wafer, and then there is red wine and white grape juice, and you can place the cups if you're receiving communion up here at the altar, or if you're receiving on the floor, you can place the small cups in the trash can that are on either side. And then once we commune this side, we will move over to my left side, your right side, moving from the front to the back. Again, it is our second time doing it. Might be a little bit clunky, but we did pretty good last week. But as I say, the most important part is that we know Jesus shows up, that Jesus promises to be here in this bread and in this wine and gives us those promises. So come and taste the joy of God. Amen.
Please rise in body or in spirit. Holy One, we thank you for the healing that springs forth from this table. Renew our strength to do justice, love kindness, and journey humbly with you.
Amen. The God who faithfully brings forth justice and breaks the oppressor's rod, bless, strengthen, and uphold you today and always. Amen.
Go in peace. Follow the way of Jesus.